Dubashi from Puducherry. And to talk against the topic, we have Dr. Vamshi Krishna from Apollo Cancer Institute, Hyderabad. So if he could please come on the stage. And for the expert comments, we have Dr. Anant Ramaswamy from TMH, Mumbai. Dr. Tiswaji.
Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Viraj and his team for giving this opportunity. The topic of debate is broad-based NGS-based profiling is the way to go for all the newly diagnosed metastatic colorectal cancer. And in 10 minutes, I will try to tell you why we need to do a broad-based NGS profiling. So these are the questions which I would like to answer in my 10 minutes. Are molecular tests relevant in a metastatic colorectal cancer? What are the relevant targetable mutations? What technique should be used for these tests? Whether we do a conventional PCR-based or we do a NGS testing? When do we do this test? Do we do it upfront when the patient comes in, or do we do it only when subsequent lines of failure? Has survival improved because of using this NGS-based testing? And the last thing would be on cost-benefit. So we know that colorectal cancers are not the same. And how did this data come up? Obviously, it came up because we had the NGS. And we have the four groups, and the four groups behave differently. The prognosis is different. Again, colorectal malignancy, you can see that they have lots of mutations. So an ideal malignancy for looking at targetable mutations. Now, the drugs which we use in metastatic colorectal cancer, we use cetuximab, which are cetuximab and panitumumab, which are EGFR inhibitors. And the first trial, the CRYSTAL trial, clearly showed that if you do not choose your patient properly, if you do not identify a KRAS wild type, then your outcomes are going to be very, very inferior. And the same thing, the next slide shows that if you actually identify a good set of patients, your median survival can be as high as 33 months. So if you go by the timelines of various advances in the treatment of metastatic colorectal cancer, you can see by 2015, your survival rates have touched almost 30 months, and I believe that in another 4-5 years, if you are going to use the NGS and we are going to guide treatment, I think this when I present this after 3 years, NGS will feature in this graph. So what are the relevant targetable mutations in metastatic colorectal cancer, and what technique should be used for this test, whether conventional or NGS? So if you go by this various studies which are available. The first study, which is by Peters et al., they looked at 320 colorectal samples with 9 genes. Most of the genes were commonly found, which is the RAS gene, the BRAF, PI3K, P10, TP53, EGFR and AKT. And the study, most of these patients received panitumumab, and the study concluded that NGS was a suitable method to identify this predictive biomarkers. The second study, which they looked at 188 samples, they looked at whether they could identify uncommon mutations and rare RAS mutations, and this study they were able to pick up some of these rare mutations. In the next study, which they looked at 12 genes and specifically looked at mutations in the MSH3, MSH6, APC and PI3K in a particular population of an Iranian population, and they found that specific diagnostic protocols and tailored therapy could be looked at specific population groups also, and NGS will help in this situation. The next study, which is a study of 138 samples, where they looked at again various rare mutations, where they found that 5% cases with MSI-H and ERBB2, and this resistant genes we could have targeted immunotherapy. The last study, which looked at a novel mutation, which is the NTRK1, for which we have a therapy now. So in a conclusion to this slide, it says that obviously NGS is a suitable method to identify predictive biomarkers. Rare RAS mutations can be identified by this, so that we don't miss out on any of this rare RAS mutations. Specific diagnostic protocols could be targeted at specific population, and we could look at resistant genes for EGFR therapy, and we could look at novel mutations. The next question is about the tumor mutational burden. We know that TMB is defined as the total number of non-synonymous mutations per coding area of a tumor genome. It can be only detected using either whole genome sequencing or targeted next generation sequencing. And by definition, there are a lot of different tumors where they have found that if you have greater than 10 mutations per megabase, which will predict survival with immunotherapy, and this could become an option for these patients. And again, the study clearly shows that if you see the graph, the colorectal cancer patients 110, the graph favors for a better overall survival when you identify this particular TMB and you give TMB based immunotherapy. What technique should be used, whether you use a conventional or NGS? We already have seen that the NGS picks up rare mutations. Also, there was a study with related to MSI testing, whether the NGS or PCR, which is better. They found that the MSI testing by NGS was validated in 138 colorectal and endometrial cancer patients, and they found that 3 patients which were missed by the PCR were picked up by using the NGS. So obviously the the sensitivity seems to be much higher with NGS when compared to the PCR. Next question is, if you identify this extra mutations and we give therapy based on this NGS based testing, has survival improved? So if you go by this meta-analysis, which shows that the impact of molecular profiling and outcome of targeted therapy, this includes all hematological and solid tumors. There were two analyses done, one with phase 1, one phase 2 by the same author in 2015 and 16, Nick, and you treat them. So this is another study where they looked at NGS based mutation analysis in advanced colorectal cancer patients and whether this could target therapy prediction, and we can clearly see that a wild type result in all 22 cancer related genes detected by NGS was associated with a better outcome with cetuximab. Obviously my counter is going to tell that the Shiva trial, which was going to be a negative trial, it was a phase 2 randomized control trial, it was a crossover trial. Though the median PFS was not different, if you go by the post-hoc analysis where they looked at the PFS ratio, PFS ratio is nothing but the PFS 2 by PFS 1, because most of these are multiply treated patients and the PFS in the subsequent treatments will be low, which could be actually a confounding factor. So they said that if the ratio exceeded 1.3, which will reflect a better treatment benefit, and you can see that 61% crossing over from the MTA to the treatment of physician choice, the PFS 2 to PFS. So, and the other negative point in that specific study and few genes were, do we do the study? There was a study which they said that robustness of this next generation sequencing on old formalin fixed paraffin embedded block, you can clearly see that the specimen stored for longer periods of time had significantly lower coverage region and lower average read depth. This means that it's better to do the NGS as fresh into the samples rather than keep them for 2-3 years and then later do it. Cost benefit, there are no specific studies related to colorectal cancer, but there is a study in metastatic melanoma where they found that in 8,900 patients diagnosed with metastatic melanoma, the gene sequencing panel could result in an annual saving of $79 million and a gain of 155 qualities. Similarly, in non-small cell lung cancer, they found that the Medicare could save up to $1.10 every. It's not changing. So my take-home message is: are molecular tests relevant in metastatic colorectal cancer? Yes. Are there relevant targetable mutations identified by NGS improve survival? Yes. What technique should be used for this test? Conventional versus NGS? NGS, better sensitivity and better identification of mutations, rare mutations. Timing of this test, whether upfront or subsequent, better do it upfront, otherwise your paraffin block will not be available later on for doing the test. Better yield and increased sensitivity in identifying RAS mutations. Cost benefit, yes. So I would like to conclude saying that I think NGS should be done for all patients with metastatic colorectal cancer. Thank you.
Good morning, and thanks to the organizers. Topic has been my 1000X ultra deep sequencing. Nice work, but when I am sitting in front of the patient, they don't really help me. Most importantly, for clinical practitioners, when we are told we are doing NGS, please understand, you are not sequencing the entire gene. Most of the companies today are actually doing only hotspots, wherein you actually sequence only parts of the gene. So, we are not actually doing an NGS. End of it, we are confused and you get a report which is 6 pages long and you do not know what to make of the 6 pages. Unfortunately, it is written in English and the patient can read it and they come and ask us questions on it. How do we answer those? Are there any other odd benefits of NGS? Rebiopsy, not required. Primary tumor is good enough. Dr. Vishwaji is nice enough to show that study. What about turnaround time? 14 to 20 days, business working days is what it takes for NGS to come. I get my KRAS NRAS in 5 days. If I tell the patient you come back after 2 weeks, I'm sorry, patient is never going to come back to any of us. What about the financial toxicity? Now the test is expensive. Ahmedabadis are rich people, probably you guys can afford it, but more or less, these kind of tests. More importantly, can we afford the treatment? NTRK, the drug cost around 40 lakhs per month. I found out for an enthusiastic Google driven patient, that's what it costs. Can anyone afford it? I would say practically no. Can NGS address issues of intratumor heterogeneity? Not really. We know this exists. How do you treat it? Nobody knows. What about liquid biopsy? The next big thing what everyone wants to talk about. Again, not yet approved. The only place it works is when you have to test for KRAS and NRAS, where you don't need NGS. So, to conclude, Dr. Vishwajit, we have a big ocean and like the Devas and Asuras, we are trying to churn out the pot of Amrit for it. But remember, we needed Menaka to give the Amrit to the actual people. So until and unless you find us the Menaka and give us what we are going to do with this test, I would conclude that as of today, no role for doing NGS broad panel testing in CRC.
So the topic was whether we need to do the NGS upfront. So the question, the answer to that point is we need to do the, you agree that we need NGS at some point or the other during the treatment of metastatic colorectal cancer. So the point is when do we do? Whether you do it at that point or you do it later. For that I showed you one slide saying that the paraffin block, you keep it longer, you will not get any data. Then it's going to be very tough for you to do that.
Well, so not your survival is 20 months.
You have shown that 20 months. You take a wild type and treat it with cetuximab, you get a median survival of 34 months. So would you not consider giving cetuximab and treat with a proper mutation? Then you said the meta-analysis clearly also says that if you use a NGS based treatment, it shows survival. The data is there. And you said that we have only two mutations and there is no point in treating the others because they are not going to show any survival benefit. And financial toxicity. Obviously, you are giving a drug, you are going to spend, even if you are using cetuximab in the current, this thing, you are going to spend 10 to 14 lakhs of worth the cost. And you are not going to spend 1 lakh to get exactly what the mutation is, because we know that if your KRAS and NRAS is mutated, your survival is going to be very poor when you are going to give cetuximab. And if you are going to miss out of any mutations, which you are not able to pick up, and you are going to give the drug, it's going to be waste. So I think it's financially, I think it is viable to do it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I read the topic properly. It is broad-based NGS testing. We are not debating about mutations. I showed you, yes, mutations need to be done, which can be done with a normal PCR. I do not need an NGS to do all those things. Definitely, I would use an anti-EGFR where indicated. In fact, like I indicated, probably we are going to add anti-HER2-new also to that, because if you have a HER2-new positive, you probably will not use an anti-EGFR. But NGS, I would not use it. Regarding the tissues, as they get older, well, in India, how many of these tissues are going to last that long? What is the storage that we have? What is the benefit? How well are these tissues preserved are all open questions. So again, I would not depend on that. Coming to the point of doing NGS down the line, well, we can always do fishing expeditions, try to find out rare mutations, find out a ATM, PT10, PTP53 mutation, and then say, okay, none of these are targetable. The idea is, are we having targetable driven mutations, driver mutations in colon cancer, less than 5% of patients. So doing a hotspot for a small panel with either PCR or some other method, maybe yes, not a broad-based panel. Thank you.